Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the 23rd meeting of the Rural Affairs and Islands Committee in 2023. Apologies have been received from Jim Fairley and Rachel Hamilton, and I'd like to welcome Jamie Halker-Johnston, who's attending as a substitute. In relation to item one, before we begin, can I ask Jamie Halker-Johnston to declare any relevant interests?
Thanks very much, Convener. Yes, I'm a partner in an organic farming business, J. Halker-Johnston & Sons. I'm the owner of a croft, and I'm a member of the NFUS and Scottish Land and Estates.
Thank you very much. Our first item of business today is a roundtable on the Welfare of Dogs Scotland Bill, and we have up to 2 hours for questions and discussions. I'd like to start the session by inviting everyone to briefly introduce themselves, and then we'll take questions from the members. So if we start off with Robbie on my left.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning. So we welcome the opportunity to provide evidence on the bill this morning. I'm here from the Law Society of Scotland. We regularly engage with bills and other government and wider stakeholder consultations and aim to develop good law. As detailed in our written evidence to the committee, we are supportive of the broad principles and intention behind the bill, which is about improving animal welfare standards in Scotland. We've identified areas of the bill, however, that we would welcome some reconsideration to achieve greater clarity or that may help achieve the intended aims behind the bill. And we look forward to discussing them later this morning.
Thank you.
Hi, I'm Julie Mendes-Ferreira, Director of Innovation and Strategic Relations at the Scottish SPCA, and thank you to the committee for inviting us today.
Thank you.
Good morning. I'm Libby Anderson. I'm the chair of the Scottish Committee for the UK Centre for Animal Law. And as I think you know, I'm also a member of the Scottish Animal Welfare Commission and would be able to speak to their submission as well, if you'd like that.
Thank you.
Good morning. I'm Ben Parker, Public Affairs Manager at Battersea Dogs and Cats Home. And thank you for inviting us to give evidence today.
Good morning, I'm Claire Calder, I'm Head of Public Affairs at Dogs Trust, and we're also very happy to be giving evidence today.
Thank you. And joining us virtually or remotely?
Hi, I'm Holly Conway, I'm Head of Public Affairs at the Kennel Club. Apologies I couldn't make it in person today, but very pleased that you allowed us to join virtually. Thank you.
Thank you very much, and thank you all for joining us. So I'll kick off the questions with a very general question. Can I ask you what you believe the main issues are with irresponsible breeding and awareness when acquiring a dog? And do you have first-hand experiences of these problems? And we'll kick off with Jilly.
Yes, so obviously the Scottish SPCA, this is something that we've been dealing with for a number of years. We do have a special investigations unit whose core purpose is to investigate particularly crimes related to serious organised crime as well. We have dealt with unscrupulous breeders for a number of years now. In 2021, we investigated 544 reports into the puppy trade. In 2022, this dropped to 124, and January to April this year, we've had 25 cases to date. In November and December last year, we uplifted over 30 breeding bitches from a breeding establishment, and a further 24 dogs, including 18 puppies, were seized on Christmas Day. We are seeing dogs that come into us very sick. We are seeing members of the public who buy pups, and within about 48 hours, those pups have died. These animals are coming in from different varieties, some coming in from Ireland. The more advice and guidance you give about asking people, you know, see the pups in a home environment, see it with its mum, what these people are now doing are renting Airbnb properties to set up that fake environment. So it's very hard. They're often using females that are not related to the pups that are there. They are also putting multiple litters across different properties to again showcase the advice that's been given. They are also now diversifying the activities into canine fertility clinics. So there's definitely been demand since the pandemic has dropped, and so they're now finding other ways, particularly for high-value breeds, breeds of dogs that cannot give birth naturally, requiring C-sections and so on. So there's lots of different health implications. We have had cases where even a young child caught Campylobacter from a puppy that they had purchased. We have obviously Giardia, and no matter what information you give the public, sometimes the hearts rule the minds. So we have had members of the public who know what they're seeing isn't the advice that they've been given, but they are still meeting someone in a car park to purchase a puppy out of the boot of a car. During the pandemic, we saw many excuses coming, saying, "Oh, you can't visit my property because I've got someone who's shielding, so I'll bring the puppy to you." So it's quite a difficult trade to disrupt, because whatever advice you put out, they're quite entrepreneurial and they'll try and appease that advice and find other ways to get around it. So it's continuing to be an issue for us, and we're continuing to disrupt. And the canine fertility clinics is now something that we are very much focused on, because that's how they've diversified into that field.
Before I bring anybody else in, you know, we want to look at the purpose of the legislation, and the policy memorandum suggests that legislation is necessary due to an increased dog population fueled by COVID, as you've said. But there's existing legislation, and you've said that you've seized puppies and intervened using legislation that's currently in place. What does this bill do that current legislation doesn't allow you to do?
I think it puts more responsibility on owners of dogs. So with this bill, it allows the opportunity, again, that transaction between when it comes to purchasing a pup, having a record, being able to prove that somebody did have the knowledge, that they should know what they're doing to look after that animal, they should know what that animal needs and should be able to provide for that. We will sometimes refer to the existing code when, as part of that prosecution, to test that kind of, would this person reasonably have known what to do to take care of that animal? And this is, again, would help strengthen that and give another kind of tool to be able to, particularly around that certificate and that sort of ownership. And that's a big challenge for us. We will get dogs in, microchip details are out of date, you can't prove who owns that animal. And that's a big challenge.
Okay. Anybody else like to come in on that? Ben?
Just to echo, I think, Gillie's points, that we agree there is a need for additional regulation to support the responsible purchase and ownership of dogs. As you spoke to, Chair, just about the COVID-19 pandemic, a well-publicised surge in demand for puppies during that period. And even though we've now seen that demand decreasing, ourselves and I'm sure others in the sector have seen an influx of puppies, adolescent dogs being brought to our centres who are perhaps, and a rise of in on-site births as well. And we're seeing some of those dogs displaying behavioural issues that may be as a result of being bred from unsuitable dogs, but also around the challenges of a lack of socialisation that those dogs had. Of course, a whole lot of new owners as well who've taken on dogs for the first time. So I think, you know, we'll come on to talk about the code of practice and the registration system, but I think, you know, we would support additional regulation at this point in time.
Thank you.
Thank you. I think just to echo what both Ben and Gillie have said. So in 2022, Dogs Trust rehomed over 700 dogs to Scottish postcodes. Last year, we had our highest number of handover calls from a member of the public in the charity's history. So we had over 50,000 handover calls, inquiries made to the charity. As Ben mentions, I think we're really seeing the kind of repercussions of things like decisions to get a dog during the COVID pandemic, the lockdowns, and also the pressures of the cost of living situation that we're seeing at the moment. So we are seeing an unprecedented number of requests for dogs to come into our care as well. I think in terms of our other experience and what we can talk about today. Dogs Trust also chairs the Pet Advertising Advisory Group. So through that group, we and other charities do work with certain engaged websites where pets can be advertised for sale. And we do get a lot of insight in terms of what those websites are seeing with the adverts. And we also run something called the Puppy Pilots, where Dogs Trust cares for dogs which are seized at the borders after being illegally imported. Through that scheme, we see a huge number of evolving tactics from unscrupulous traders. So, for example, we've seen situations such as fake mums being presented as, you know, there's a lot of messaging to always see a puppy with its mum, but it's very easy to get a fake mum and pass that off as the puppy's mum. We've seen other tactics such as renting homes to look as though the puppy's come from that home environment. We've seen things such as microchips being put into, been put on the dog's ear or in their fur, so they can easily be removed, and a UK microchip can be used instead. And these are puppies that have been transported in very often really awful conditions for many, many hours across Europe. So I think in terms of what we would like to see, one of our big concerns at the moment is that we don't have a system with full traceability across all dog breeding and sale. So I think what this bill presents is an opportunity to really look at registration of anybody who is breeding or selling a dog, and really close that loophole where currently anybody breeding less than 3 litters can completely evade the system. So I think that's one of the biggest things that we're interested in through this bill.
Okay, I'm interested, you know, the code, you've touched on the code about people wanting to see their mothers and Airbnbs being used, but the effect of the code is it doesn't, in practice, make the person liable for any proceedings. So at the end of the day, it's just a document that you've got to pay regard to, or you don't need to. So what does this bill, what teeth does it have to put in place some of the safeguards that you've suggested?
I think at the moment the code of practice side of things is very much is a tool in terms of educating the public and knowing what to ask when they're buying a dog, and that is really, really important, because again, we've seen situations where it's just so easy for anybody looking to get a dog to be duped. And so that public awareness and onus on the public to ask the right questions is important. But I think importantly, the other part of the bill that looks at a registration system, I think we've got some suggestions of how that part of the bill could be tightened up and really be an opportunity for Scotland to introduce full traceability across breeding and selling of dogs.
Libby.
Thank you, Convener. Just to pick up on what Claire's been saying, you were asking about the legislation. So in order for the Scottish SPCA to intervene, that would be the Animal Health and Welfare Scotland Act. But, of course, that does not prevent the suffering occurring. And the cases that I read the other day on the SSPCA website were truly pitiful, truly, truly appalling suffering. So that is what the legislation is aiming to prevent. In terms of prevention, we have the licensing. But as Claire said, that's only if you have 3 litres or more per year. And the anomaly is that the standards that apply to licensed breeders are completely absent when it comes to hobby breeder, low-level breeders. So that, as Claire is saying, is closing up that loophole, and that would be through the registration rather than the code. But just a couple of other things that the bill has the potential to address. Because the code in particular focuses on the person acquiring the dog and aims to educate them, it has the opportunity to address matters like the fashion for acquiring dogs who are, by their very nature and breeding, not going to lead good lives. And the most egregious example of that is obviously the brachycephalic dogs, who literally have difficulty in breeding and sleeping and reproducing. So by educating and by asking people through the code to ask themselves that question, that is an opportunity for the bill. And also, it would require people to explore whether their lifestyle and their routines are suitable for keeping a dog, because again, that's something that has been found with the acquisition of dogs through the pandemic and now the relinquishment of dogs, which is going up all the time. And this is because people were getting dogs without really being aware of what was a good plan.
Okay, thanks. Holly.
Yeah, thank you. I just was coming back to your original question of what are the main issues with irresponsible dog breeding. From our perspective, the main issue is that irresponsible dog breeders can get away with it. The demand is there. There's huge demand for puppies. It has levelled off, but the demand is still there. And there are current regulations in place, but they're not enforced adequately. So therefore, if you're a bad breeder, if you're a rogue breeder, if you're importing illegally bred dogs, you can pretty much get away with it. we FOI local authorities regularly, and there should have been when the regulations since when the regulations were introduced and the litter threshold was lowered from 5 litres to 3 litres, there should have been a threefold increase in the number of licences being issued to dog breeders, but there has only been a 10% uplift. So one of our concerns is we do welcome the principle of the bill, but currently the regulations that are in place at the moment tackle the volume breeders and not being enforced properly. So even though we welcome a registration system, and it's certainly a really good thing to have standards for all breeders, we know that home breeders are more likely to breed dogs responsibly. I think there's been research alluded to in the papers done by RSPCA and University of Edinburgh that the puppy farms are the problem, they're the main cause of the problem, and that's currently not being dealt with properly. But partly, or a big part of that, is also because people don't know what questions to ask. So with regards to the codes that are being introduced, we do think that's really important, because currently there's a lot of onus on breeders and that's not being enforced. But there's no requirements for people to actually do their research properly before they get a dog, which is really key, because that is what's driving the demand. And if people knew, and if people took the time to properly research what they were getting, they might think twice, and there might be fewer calls to rescue centres as a result, because people would have worked harder and put the effort in to know what questions to ask themselves. And we did a PuppyWise survey just back in August, and a fifth of people still spend less than 2 hours researching whether to get a puppy. This is a 15-year commitment, and people are spending less than 2 hours researching, and nearly a third have admitted they wouldn't know how to spot a rogue breeder. So for us, the educational piece behind this is actually really important, because ultimately we need members of the public to be demanding better standards of breeders.
Holly, can I just clarify something? You referred to regulations. Can we just be sure what regulations you are talking about and whether they actually apply in Scotland?
Yeah, the most recent breeding regulations, which came in 2021.
Okay, thank you. That's helpful. To explore the code of practice, whatever, in more detail. But just before we move on, one thing that I'm uncertain about is actually whether the purpose of the legislation is going to deliver more than what we've got at the moment. And it appeared to me the only obligation there is on the government as it stands is to create a code. Now, the government are able to create a code practice at the moment, but have chosen not to do it. This legislation forces them to do that. But anything else, it's the government may legislate for this or may do that. Can I ask Robbie, does this really go far enough in ensuring that all the concerns we've just heard are actually addressed legally?
Yeah, thank you, Convener. I think there's a few points here. As you say, there is the existing power under the 2006 Act to introduce a code of practice that's been in place since 2010, the current code of practice. As you say, Section 1 does provide that obligation on Scottish ministers to introduce the code, so in that sense it does move along the progression and ensures that a code under the bill would be produced reflecting the provisions in the code, looking at sort of pre-purchase and the relations there. I understand that from other responses and when we've looked at it as well, there's the potential for overlap between the existing powers to create a code and the code here. We don't have any particular comments as such on the merit of having two separate codes. Our main comment there would just be around ensuring that there's no contradiction or overlap between the codes. Ultimately, I think, as some of the other members here today have said, that a lot of this will come down to public awareness of the code. So to that extent, we welcome the provisions in, I think, Section 11 and Section 7 of the bill, which looks about the police obligation of Scottish ministers to take reasonable steps to ensure public awareness. But ultimately, we've looked as well at enforcement powers, and you've mentioned that this morning, Convener. As you say, that there isn't the teeth as such in the enforcement mechanisms of the code at Part 1. Similarly, at Part 2, there's concerns around enforcement mechanisms. We've mainly looked at the fact that it's all by secondary legislation, that Scottish ministers may do X or Y. From our perspective, that's problematic because there's not the same level of parliamentary scrutiny for that. So I think when we're talking about enforcements, it's helpful to look at part one enforcements and part two enforcements as opposed to enforcement in a sort of general sense.
Well, we'll probably move on to those in more details we'll go through. Alistair Allan.
Thank you, Convener. A number of you have identified problems in the current way in which this trade operates, and I just wonder whether you could say a bit more about whether you think the code is the answer to that in terms of it having a potentially deterrent effect on people who are responsible for bad practice. And on a technical point, perhaps one for the Law Society, perhaps something for others, the bill does set out to some extent what the code should and shouldn't contain, and I just wonder, is that normal practice in legislation? Does anyone have comments on the approach that the bill takes to that?
Libby?
Thank you. First of all, if I could look at the question of the two codes and potential duplication, which was raised, if I may, and then come back to the content of the bill. So there is a slight difference in status between the 2006 Act code, which would have to be laid before the Scottish Parliament and approved by a resolution. So that's absent from this bill. But as has been said, there would be duplication, and we think that for the public to understand what is expected of them, which is the aim of the code, really, to educate the public, it would be better to make this as simple and as accessible as possible. With regard to the content of the code being on the face of the bill, I think we were a bit surprised to see that, and I dare say Robbie would have a comment to make on that as well. I think the drawback to that is that it's inflexible. The primary legislation would have to be amended every time you wanted to change the code, and science and understanding of behaviour and human behaviour all change. It seems really rather rigid to have it on the face of the bill. I've got one or two questions about the actual content that's recommended, and I'm sure other people will as well, but just to finish off this point. Possibly it could be in a schedule which would be more easily amended, and I'm sure I have seen that sort of recommendation, these specifics. But I think it would be better in some ways to put the responsibility, the obligation on the Scottish ministers to promote good practice via a code, and then to leave the detailed content to more intensive work to be carried out in the fullness of time. So long as it happens, because it's good that the obligation is there.
Yeah, I think we would echo much of what Libby just said there. We were also have submitted similar comments around the appropriateness of including such detailed guidance and wording in the primary legislation itself in relation to the code for similar reasons in relation to flexibility. We've pulled out, maybe help for the committee to look at, a few examples of analogous codes, one of which comes from the 2006 Act. So that's the Animal Health and Welfare Scotland Act 2006. Section 37, that is the power to introduce existing code that we see, 2010 code, that uses language to the effect that the code may make provisions about certain things, and that's the type of model that we would expect to see consistency across the statute book in this area. There's also another analogous code that we've looked at in the case of the Police Ethics Conduct and Scrutiny Scotland Bill that's for the Parliament at the moment, and similarly section 2 of that bill refers to things that may have regard to in the code, but these are not in the same level of detail as proposed under the bill that the committee is looking at just now.
Okay. Clear.
I think another challenge with the code, and I'm sure it will come up later in the session as well, is public awareness of the code. So we've got existing codes of practice for dogs and cats in Scotland, but we know public awareness of those are very, very low. So as part of the suggestions from the member putting forward the bill, I know that a public awareness campaign has been included. I think we would strongly, strongly suggest that is needed for the public to understand the content of the code and what is being suggested for them.
Okay, thank you. Ariane Burgess.
Thank you. Thank you, Convener. I think I'll address my question initially to Robbie. So this is still on the code of practice. And so I understand there's an existing code, and I'd be interested to hear if that code could simply be updated.
I understand there's the powers under the 2006 Act to allow for the code to be revised. It's not a point that we've looked at in detail, and I think would ultimately be a case of whether the government would want to update that code. I think we referred earlier to the fact that the bill would provide the impetus to ensure that Scottish ministers would produce a separate code, and that there may be merit in a combined approach there. But it's not something that we have considered in detail in our written submissions.
So what this bill is doing would provide that impetus for them to actually take forward a code?
I think the point would be that the bill would introduce the obligation to create a separate code, and then there may be, as the bill progresses, a desire for a sort of streamlined process there, that giving the existing powers, and if the bill progressed, that may sort of give that impetus to think about a streamlined approach, but it's not something that we have actually looked at in detail on that.
Thanks very much. Anybody else got any comments about that?
Nope. Gillian.
I think just in practical terms, again, thinking of the end user here, we've got a member of the public who needs to have that knowledge and understanding. When our inspector's in a house, having multiple documents is not an easy way to prove that somebody has managed to grasp all that knowledge if they're required to look at various sources of information. So I suppose our plea here is to have it simple. If it's updating and revising an existing code, that would be better from a practical terms as well, to prove whether that person should have had that knowledge or not, as part of an investigation.
Okay.
Ben.
I think, you know, by the nature of its term, a code of practice perhaps sounds a little bureaucratic and not as engaging or as accessible as it might need to be to fulfil its role. I think, you know, we really do feel like there is a role here for further education of the public around the responsibilities of dog ownership, to kind of echo Gillian's point, I think. And I know, I'm sure we'll come on to the specific details of what should be within the code of practice, but things like, you know, it could act as a useful tool to outline even some advice on pet care costs. So, for example, we estimate that it costs £2,000 a year to keep a dog. You know, at this current moment of time, when lots of people are struggling with the cost of living, they may not be aware that is the figure that you would expect in relation to dog ownership. So there are things that the code of practice could do in terms of including advice and redirecting and signposting to existing advice and support elsewhere too, and happy to detail some of the things that we think are perhaps missing from the code at the moment when we get to that point in the session.
Okay, thank you. Alistair Allen.
Thank you. I just wonder if I can ask a wee bit more about this question of duplication around the code, but specifically around sections 2-4, or parts 2-4, forgive me. Do they actually place any new legal obligations on buyers and sellers? I know, Gillian, you think you touched on this, but are we dealing with something that's purely advisory, or will people experience new legal obligations as a result of this?
I think from the code is advisory. You can utilise it as a tool in amongst the existing legislation under the Animal Health and Welfare Scotland Act. But yes, the code is an advisory tool. I know we're going to come on to sort of registration and certificates and so on, which would have a bit more weighting. And the biggest challenge is lack of traceability that Claire's obviously covered. And we feel that this bill could be used as a vehicle to try and get us to that really optimum solution of having that traceability.
I've got Beatrice Wishart.
I think we'll come on to the required content of the code. So do you agree with the required content, and do you think that the content should be specified on the face of the bill? And is there anything missing from the prescribed content? And we've seen respondents made a number of suggestions for additional things which could be prescribed on the face of the bill, including microchipping requirements, vaccination needs, providing proper care for a dog, and as Libby alluded to, the risks of flat-faced breeds. I don't know who wants to kick off with that first.
Maybe Ben was going to comment on that.
Yeah. Yes, thank you. I'm happy to. So I think, it's, as I say, the Code of Practice could serve as a useful tool to outline some advice on pet care costs, firstly. I think also it ought to include advice on whether purchasing a puppy is right for an individual, and on how to source a puppy, including what questions to ask the breeder as well. I think there's actually a role for talking up, as you'd expect me to say, representing Battersea here today, but the role of the rescue sector here to help ease some of the pressures on the system. The umbrella group for the sector, the Association of Dogs and Cats Home, recently had annual returns in showing that reporting rescues are already at 90% capacity. So I think when we're looking at people looking to get a dog, you know, that opportunity again to talk up the role of rescue, the fact that you're potentially taking a dog that's, you know, had a lot of medical behavioural checks already, it'd be a welcome opportunity to flag that. I think there's currently no clause under Section 3 proposals which highlight the legal requirement for a puppy of 8 weeks or more to be microchipped and registered on a compliant database. We obviously, I think, would all be well aware of the huge benefits of the microchipping system. For the first time in 7 years this year, a survey that Battersea has conducted with local authorities across the UK has indicated a rise in the stray dog population. So that is something that we would want to continue to push, the importance of microchipping. Again, under Section 3, we can talk about a clause which outlines that puppies should be fully vaccinated before sale. There's also some contents under Section 3 that states before acquiring the dog, the prospective acquirer is, unless this is not practicable, to see the dog with the bitch which gave birth to it. And I think perhaps there could that say instead, unless this is not practicable for welfare reasons, because there's a potential loophole that we'd be a bit worried about there, where, you know, somebody is purchasing a puppy without seeing it with its mother. But, you know, if you made that slight change, you would also respect the possible welfare reasons that the mother might not be able to be present there. And finally, just to echo that point I was making before around the presentation challenge of a code of practice, you know, how do you make this feel engaging, feel relevant, feel attractive to users, and not something that's there to punish them as well?
Clear.
I would agree with Ben's suggestions there. I think one of the challenges with the detail that's given on the face of the bill is that it is relatively limited compared to what would need to be considered before acquiring a dog. We certainly agree that there could be a potential issue there with the wording around seeing a puppy with its mum, but under the licensing of activities involving animals regulations for dog breeding, there are two very specific clauses of when that could be acceptable, for example, if the mum has deceased. So I would suggest that it would make sense to replicate that wording. And then for us, because there is this suggestion of two separate codes of practice at the moment, I think we'd be really keen if you know, as Gilly said, it makes perfect sense to streamline that into one code of practice if possible. But if you were looking at two different codes, both codes would need to clearly reference each other and be named in a way which made it very clear that the second code was referring to the sale and acquisition of dogs, whereas the other code refers to the dog's lifetime.
Karen Adam.
Thank you, convener. Just listening to some of the discussion there, my focus during all of this, I keep thinking about purebred dogs, and I think that's where the conversation seems to be tied in. And I'm not quite seeing how this would fit into just mixed breed dogs, people whose dog has been caught out, or, you know, somebody in a local community's dog has had puppies. So, for example, if they were to be had to be vaccinated before the person took the puppy within this code of practice, perhaps there's an affordability issue there as well, whereas the person taking the puppy would be, you know, willing to do that. I can see where this fits in with purebred dogs, but can I just ask, where does this fit in with that scenario that I've just mentioned?
I'd like to come in. Holly, possibly with the kennel club.
Yeah, and so with people, so I presume you mean pedigree dogs, but yeah. The codes, are you referring to if someone has an accidental litter, for example, like a one-off accidental litter?
Yes, or yeah.
Because I think the code is applicable to all dogs, pedigree, crossbreed. The code is there. I agree with Ben and with Claire. It would be great to actually make this like a more positive piece rather than calling code of practice something that you can engage with dog owners, because so many of them don't know how to spot an irresponsible breeder. So actually it could be, it's really positive. It does apply, from my understanding, applies to all dogs, pedigree, crossbreed. But yes, if you have an accidental litter, I suppose that was your point, that how can you then ensure that you've completely done the right thing? But then again, it's, to my mind, this is more of an educational piece. It's something that would be considered in a court of law if there was a case of abuse or cruelty or something like that, as part of a wider investigation. That's my understanding of it. It's not something that if you didn't do every single aspect of this code, you would be committing an offence. So I believe, from my understanding, it's following this as closely as you can. This is the gold standard of good practice, and it's putting, I think, more just generally putting more emphasis on buyers to know what to look for. So if they were looking for a range of things, and as you said, okay, that the vaccinations weren't there because it was an accidental litter, but I'm asking other questions and everything else was done, then on balance you think, okay, that was a one-off accidental litter, I'll go ahead. But if everything else also doesn't marry up and you're getting lots of red flags, then it paints more of a picture. That was my understanding, but I believe it applies to all dogs.
Jilly.
Holly, I agree. I think it wouldn't have to apply to all dogs. I don't think you could go down that route. People are breeding or doing mixed breeds all the time now, and it'd be very hard to actually track and to make this have an impact. It would have to be down for all dogs. Something else that the Scottish SPCA has been looking at, we've been working with other SPCAs in Australia, New Zealand, British Columbia and England and Wales, around the use of five domains model of animal welfare by Mellor. So that's going beyond the sort of five freedoms, and it's trying to encourage that you need to provide animals with positive experiences. They will get negative, but it's that kind of balance between the two. And that's, again, a situation that our inspectors face time and time, where people are meeting the bare standards according to existing legislation under the five freedoms. But you need them to go above that. You need to have those positive experiences, and that, again, influences the behaviour and everything as well. So I think, again, this is an opportunity to utilise this to enhance advice and guidance that's actually going to have a bigger impact on the dog population. We've spoken a lot about dogs with behavioural issues because they've not had the right socialisation. They've come from areas. So I think with this code has to cover all breeds of dogs, crossbreeds included, and it needs to go beyond the five freedoms and look at things like the five domains.
Before going on to the next question, can I maybe ask a question? So it would appear that the really important thing is buyers and sellers understanding what's good for animal welfare. And we've got four or five animal welfare charities around the table whose main job is, well, not main job, but one of their main jobs is public awareness, telling people how they should buy a puppy, how they should look after a puppy. Should we not just put a bit of pressure on the government to update their code and then provide funding for you guys to do the public awareness bit, because that's ultimately what you're good at? And is there not more chance for the puppy purchaser out in the street there to listen to the Dogs Trust or Battersea or SSPCA than they are to the government? Should we not just be looking for the government to do the right thing, update the code without being forced to through legislation, and provide funding to ensure the public awareness campaigns are effective? Any comment, Libby?
Well, I think the value of the exercise here is that it does put the pressure on the Scottish Government, and it does allow for this discussion about what should be not quite an obligation on people acquiring dogs, because it doesn't have a legal status, it doesn't contain an offence, but it does have evidentiary status. So if there is a proceeding for an offence, compliance or non-compliance with the code will be taken into account. But it does give us the opportunity to look at what really should be very nearly obligations on people acquiring dogs. And in response to Karen Adams' question, I think this is where the certificate is the very crucial part of it, and that's something that is not contained in the current model of the code at present. But I've just forgotten what I was going to say now about, well, it's about the content of the code. It gives us the opportunity to put in so much more detail. And the point I was going to make is that charities like Dogs Trust, Scottish SPCA, Battersea have been banding together for years in very effective Buy a Puppy Safely campaign, Say No to Puppy Dealers. This problem is so intractable because, as we heard at the beginning, the people engaging in the criminal activity are so determined to do it and so cynical and, you might say, so heartless. They will go on and they will find a way around this. So the attempt to change the emphasis is what the bill's all about. But I do completely take your point about whether it should be one amalgamated code, and I think I would agree with that ultimately.
OK, we're going to move on quite nicely to the certificates. A question from Kate Forbes.
Thanks very much and good morning. A few questions on certificates. Obviously, to start off with, hearing the evidence thus far, there's been a lot of emphasis on the breeders and the fault lying there. Whereas a certificate, of course, is presumably designed to try and trigger a commitment from the buyer to care for the puppy. And I've got quite a few questions on this, but do you think that balance is right then in terms of the proposal here? Where do you think the balance of responsibility should lie? On the buyer or on the breeder? And secondly, obviously there are some informal certificates already that buyers can commit to, but not enshrined in legislation. And so my second question is, what learnings have you seen from previous certificates, informal certificates, that have worked? What are the right questions to be triggering that commitment amongst the buyer? And I don't know who wants to go first.
Robbie.
Hi there, thank you. I think we're better placed to speak to the first part of that question. I think others in the room would be better on the sort of work-lived experience of previous certificates. We've made a few comments on the, as you say, the balance between the supplier and the purchaser of the dog. The certificates to be signed by both parties, with both parties' details to be included on them. However, the content of the certificate does seem to be slightly lopsided in that the purchaser has to, for example, confirm that they've checked with the supplier and believe the dog is at least 8 weeks of age. That's section 4B1. There's a few aspects there linking back as well to section 3. So, for example, section 3, subsection 4A, that the purchaser has become familiar with the circumstances, and then 4B, take all reasonable steps to establish. That's in relation to licensing or regulation, registration. And the point that we see is that there's a role there for the supplier to come in. For example, placing the obligation on the purchaser to confirm that they believe the dog is at least 8 weeks of age. That feels like one that would be appropriate further to be for the supplier to confirm that the dog is 8 weeks of age, or that at least there's an ability for both parties to continue that. And we appreciate that there is obviously a wider educational piece here, and it's about collaboration between the supplier and the purchaser, but there are aspects that we think that balance could be added to rather than necessarily having to be redrawn.
Oh, beg your pardon, Holly indicated she'd like to come and see a hand up.
Thank you. I see your point that when you look at this bill in isolation, it looks like the balance is off because there's much more emphasis placed here on the buyer than there is on the breeder. But in context, there is a lot that the current regulatory environment is, the emphasis is all on the breeder, and it's not working as well as it should. And that's because, as I said before, the demand is still there. So I see this as a way of members of the public becoming more engaged, hopefully better educated, and them demanding better of breeders, so that it kind of complements the legislation that's already out there. So even though it seems like the balance is off at the moment, there's nothing that buyers have to do, and as a result, they don't know how to source a puppy responsibly, and breeders are exploiting this. So that's why I think within the context of all the regulations that are out there on this issue, it is quite a good balance, because for the first time, it does place that responsibility, give some responsibility to people when they're looking to buy a dog as well. Because ultimately, even though the regulations exist for breeders, that they're not being enforced properly, and the problem isn't really going to be tackled unless buyers start demanding more and demanding better.
One of my follow-up questions was going to be, and it might be worth asking it now, just in case anybody else wants to come in, is the extent to which adding perhaps more requirements onto the buyer, including adding more costs into the process, might push buyers into trying to circumvent the formal process and therefore make the situation even worse. So, for example, if you know that going to somebody's home and you've got to answer the certificate, complete the certificate, and you've got to perhaps pay more for the whole process, that might make some more inclined to do the back of the car in a car park. I don't know, perhaps that's unfair and incorrect.
Gillie?
I think, obviously, every time you put an onus on the public to do another task or another process, you're going to have that risk, and there'll always be people who want to get a better deal, do things. And again, it comes back to people following their hearts, not their heads. And we've have got plenty of evidence where people have done that. They know standing in a car park with a pup and a boot is the wrong thing to do, but I want to go and rescue that pup, because otherwise who else is going to do it? So there is we've talked a lot about education. I think with the certificate, by having that agreement between a buyer and a seller, it also gives the buyer that onus, a bit of a comeback as well, and to challenge the seller on things. It's obviously optional. There are contracts agreements out there that some buyers and sellers do use. There is the risk, again, when you produce more documents, we see it with horse passports and things like that, people will create their own versions and their own numbers. And again, that comes back to that registration of this type of activity and where these certificates logged and so on. So I think you will always have that risk when you're asking somebody to do something and going above and beyond. But at the moment, it's very much, there's a lot on the breeders. We need to challenge now the buyers, and we need to actually change that pathway so that they take more ownership and responsibility.
Ben?
I'm just going to come in quickly on the certificate as a general point. I guess, you know, as the code of practice is non-statutory, there's obviously not really the incentive for people to obtain, keep or carry the certificate. And I think, furthermore, speaking to your point on costs, it's not really clear how much this would cost at the moment or who would issue the certificate. So some of that detail needs to be worked out. And I think you could argue that for it to be effective, it would need to be a legal requirement with a clear enforcement mechanism for no compliance, such as the use of fixed penalty notices. So I think there are all of those considerations to make as we look at this piece of legislation as it stands at the moment.
Gillie, I'd like to come back in.
Add in just one bit. At the moment, it says that the certificate may need to be shown to a police officer or inspector in response to a reasonable request, but there's no real consequence for failing to do so. So just bringing back in sort of Ben's point. So again, that needs to be considered, obviously, as this progresses.
Yeah, currently, the certificate's only, you know, the people who are likely to have a certificate are those who are aware already and want to do the right thing. So it doesn't address where the issue is. So if you want to sell puppies out the back of a car, the certificate makes no difference. It's going to be something, you know, it's a valueless piece of paper. And, I don't know how that can, an extra hoop for people to jump through is going to incentivise those who are not minded to follow the code to do that extra miles. You touched on a chipping. Now, it's a legal obligation. Have we got any idea just how many people do chip their dogs, how many don't? Is that policed in any way? Do SSPCA do random chip checks? Because we're looking at something that's actually in place in legislation just now, which are very physical. You know, you can tell whether a dog has got a chip or not. But all the stuff we're looking at the moment is all very, in practice, how can you check that someone has seen the bitch. How many checks can you do to make sure they're conscious of the cost of keeping a dog? That's all very intangible, whereas chipping is tangible. Do we have any idea whether people are abiding by that, given that there's not a national database of as such?
Point about the national database. Microchipping is obviously, like other organisations, will scan every dog that comes into our care. It's quite difficult at the moment with microchipping because different manufacturers have different databases that you have to check. So when a dog comes in, you have to check multiple databases to figure out if the dog's details are up to date. We find that details are not up to date either. So again, you can't prove ownership. Having one centralised system would be something that I think we've all been calling for a very long time, because that makes it very challenging. There will be dogs out there that are not microchipped, and certainly we will get dogs in that have not been microchipped, and obviously we will then microchip them ourselves. The biggest challenge is, because you have so many manufacturers now, you don't have a national database, making it very hard for that traceability. We also have, again, bring back to scrupulous dealers, that they will purchase mass bundles of microchips, and again trying to prove the domains of where that animal has come from, so they will falsify that as well. So that is something, again, we've seen through a lot of our cases.
Okay. Karen.
Thank you, Convener. Section 1 of the legislation specifies that Scottish ministers must make a code of practice in relation to buying, selling or transferring dogs as pets. And I was just wondering, would there be... Where's the space in this for working dogs? Should there be a space for working dogs? To open that up to.
Clear.
I think we would like any code of practice to apply to all dogs. So the existing code of practice for the welfare of dogs does apply to any domesticated dog that is under the control of a person. So I think that is what we would anticipate for any new code of practice as well. I don't think we would want to see any kind of differentiation between different kinds of dogs in terms of the way they're kept being a factor in that.
Yep, Holly, do you want to come in?
In terms of kind of the Kennel Club remit, we have like sections of our community that will work dogs. And I did see, like in one of the submissions, there was a proposal for an exemption from this for working dogs. From our perspective, obviously, if you're in the community of working your dogs, the very high chances are you will know what questions to ask, and you will be, I suppose, more aware of what you're looking for than general members of the public who are purchasing a puppy for the first time. So perhaps the code is less relevant because it's not needed as much by that community. However, it wouldn't, at the same time, it wouldn't really impact them, because they would be doing these things and asking these questions anyway. It would essentially be that they would be signing an additional piece of paper. So personally, we didn't flag this as an issue.
Okay, thank you. Ben.
I think, you know, the existing animal welfare legislation is obviously designed to protect all animals. So if this law is to be passed, I'm not sure why, for example, working dogs would earn less protections at the point of breeding, even if they're being bred for a defined purpose. And I think also, you know, if you've got welfare requirements which specific working dogs have related to their purpose that don't apply to the general dog population, the police, for example, are free to pursue their own standards in addition to that baseline. But as I say, I think if this law is to be passed, you know, we wouldn't see that working dogs would earn, for example, less protections at the point of breeding than any other.
Clear? Nothing to add.
I think it all ties back as well to Julie's previous point about the kind of user experience and the benefits of streamlining everything into one code. So given the existing code of practice applies to all dogs, I think there's a huge argument there for all dogs being included in any additional code, or if you know, there was a way forward with one code as well.
Okay, thank you. Karen.
It does specify as pets, so it's just to get clarity on that, and your statements on that. You're saying that as pets should be changed to all dogs.
Okay. Thank you. We're now going to move on to look at part two, the register of unlicensed litters. Alistair Allen.
Thank you very much. On this point about unlicensed litters, I'm kind of building on the point that Karen made earlier about perhaps one-off litters. I just wonder, is there a need for a sort of de minimis provision about this? Is there a need for a provision that recognises any difference with low-volume breeders? Or, on the contrary, do you feel there's currently a need for more regulation around low-volume breeders?
Clara?
So, going back to what I mentioned at the start of the session in terms of the lack of traceability currently for all dogs being bred and sold, I think the suggestion of registration for anybody who is breeding or selling dogs under the current licensing threshold, that would be a way for anybody, for example, who just had one litter to be captured within the system and provide that traceability across the system without being overly onerous on them as well. I think one of the challenges at the moment is it is very easy to evade the licensing requirements, and that just fuels the lack of transparency and traceability across the system. So that's why I think a few things on the suggestion for registration, though. I think we would really like it to apply to breeders. So at the moment, the wording is focused on litters. I think we want breeders to be captured. And the other thing is really, really importantly, is the current proposal doesn't require a register to be introduced. It's up to the Scottish Government to do so. I think we would really like to see a requirement included on the face of the bill as well.
I think I know what register of unlicensed litters means, but to many people reading that, there will be an inherent contradiction in the idea of registering people who have not licensed themselves. How do you do that? I think I know what it means, but can you understand why to many people that would seem a strange idea?
So, as in, how would they be captured if they fall under the litter limit? So, I think there is the suggestion that it would be a lower level of information that would be captured. So, obviously, you'd need their name and postcode and different details. But the difference with licensing is that there would be active inspections on animal welfare standards, and this would be a level below that. I think if you look also at the local authority responses to the committee's consultation on this, the two councils that did submit applications were very keen on the suggestion of registration. And the reason for that is because it brings every breeder into their site. They've got the ability to do so much more in terms of enforcement if there was traceability across the system as well.
Okay, Holly.
From our perspective, we do have a policy that we do support the principle of the compulsory registration and everybody having that number there before you sell a puppy, because it gives some degree of certainty to the buyer, and it helps in that education piece. You know, if you've got that number beside your advert, then you've gone through some kind of checks and balances process. However, the issue that we have is that we think at the moment it's potentially too soon to bring this in. We know that there's a lot of issues with enforcement currently for higher volume breeders that I alluded to before. At the moment, for example, there's only 175 licensed breeders in Scotland. Obviously, there's a lot more, but they're slipping under the radar. So it's our view that whilst there's a lot more that can be done, and they will be good things to do, it's timing is everything, because the demand for puppies is there, and we don't want to cut off a good supply as well. So at the moment, until we've got the kind of enforcement right at that higher volume level, bringing in more for the home breeders and the lower volume, when we know that can potentially turn some people off of breeding, it's about timing, and it's about striking the balance. We want the lower volume breeders, the home breeders, to continue to breed. We would like more of them to breed, because we know that people breeding fewer dogs in a loving environment are much more likely to get a healthy, happy pet at the end of it. So for us, it's always about striking that balance and incentivising the lower volume breeders to maybe breed if they're confident and they're following advice, to breed a litter because they would probably do a good job of it. Just to give some context, within the breeders that we register, over a huge proportion will only ever register one or two litters in their lifetime, never mind per year. So we're looking at a very cottage industry. It's quite a niche area. So those are our concerns, really, is the enforcement and the timing and getting the balance right.
Julie?
Yeah, I think, so one of the things, so there's a requirement obviously for the choir to check that the person they're getting the dog from is either a licensed breeder or has registered the litter. But as far as we're aware, there are no intentions for the registered unlicensed breeders to be made public. So anyone conceivably could make up a series of letters, numbers and pass off that indeed they're registered. There needs to be some sort of publicly searchable database to allow that. Resource, as Holly's mentioned, that is a big stumbling block, because you can bring all these things in, and I've said it before in this room, you can have the best piece of legislation and codes of practice or whatever it is, but if you don't have the resource to do those checks to enforce, then it doesn't work. And that's something we've seen time and time. There's a lot going being allocated to local authorities. This will be another thing that they will be required to do. Money is not ring-fenced to do this. Who's going to manage the databases and so on. So to make this be effective and to work, that needs to be considered, and the resource needs to be put in place.
Clear on then, Ben.
Just to add to what Gillie's just mentioned, I think it is really important that the database of everybody registered is publicly available. But I think an additional requirement that will be really, really important to the effectiveness and that provision of traceability will be a requirement for any advert for a dog being sold to have either the registration number or the licence number included on the advert as well.
And just to echo that again, there should be some form of the register accessible to the public, again, with just some basic information about the breeder, including their name, registration number and their area of operation, perhaps, as well. And just to put on record as well that we've long advocated for a registration system for breeders below the licensing threshold to deter unethical breeders, to improve canine welfare, to increase traceability and aid enforcement. We've been pushing for this for a long time in England and Wales too, and I think there's, it's been slow progress, being honest, so I think there's an opportunity here for Scotland to lead the way on this. And ultimately, it's a welcome step towards ensuring that there's at least some form of traceability and documentation for each puppy. And I think in the context of recent concerns about public safety around dogs, that is ever more important too.
Thank you. Rhoda.
Thanks. Can I ask if you agree with the proposed scheme and whether the powers in the bill are required, given that there are powers in the Animal Health and Welfare Scotland Act that allow the requirement for a registration scheme as well?
Clear.
So the Scottish Government currently can introduce registration under the Animal Health and Welfare Scotland Act, but I think the challenge is that they haven't. So I think if this bill could be amended to require that register to be introduced, I think that would be a very important step forward.
Ben?
I'd just echo that, simply.
Yeah. Okay. Without traceability, none of the things we're talking about are actually going to be effective. Could the argument be that simply what we need is a mandatory registration scheme for puppies and they're microchipped, so there's full traceability with all the information required behind, so name of breeder, where the dogs were bred, where they've been housed. Would that not just circumnavigate all this bill, which doesn't place any requirements on government at all? But so back to the good old days, if you like, where we had dog licences, but that dog licence scheme could be on a nationwide database to allow better checks, better scrutiny of breeders, whether they were puppy farmers, if you like, breeding multiple times, or the small scale unregistered litters as at the moment. Would that not be a solution rather than all these little bits in another bill? Any comments? Clear.
So I think one of the differences here is that dog licensing would apply to the owners of dogs, whereas what we'd really like to see through this proposal for a register is registration of breeders of dogs. And I think that's what is really, really important for that traceability across the system of dog breeding and selling. We did also mention as part of our submission to the committee that another way that could also be considered could be to amend the microchipping legislation to require anybody who is registering a puppy for the first time a mandatory field to input who the breeder was. I think that would be an important step forward in traceability as well. But I think, importantly, what we need to capture here is some form of traceability of breeders, which is the really important part.
Ben.
Yeah, I think, you know, perhaps the vehicle by which this happens we wouldn't take a stronger view on. It's just important that it does happen. You know, the registration of breeders is something we've pushed for so long. And you know, to go back to your point on microchipping as well, just from before, it's so important for us. And I think since compulsory dog microchipping was introduced in 2016, I think our latest stats are that something like 20% of dogs that arrive at Battersea are unchipped, compared to 60% of cats. And obviously, the government in Westminster has promised to bring in compulsory cat microchipping from next year. But it speaks to the importance of microchipping and that being signposted to, as Claire says, wherever possible as well.
Libby?
I think your point about traceability relating to microchipping is absolutely correct, but that really affects the individual dog. And the point of the registration, and as Claire says, we would support it being a register of breeders rather than litters, and that ensures not only the traceability but also the transparency and the accountability of the breeder. And if anybody is attempting to register separate litters and actually is breeding above the threshold, so they should come under the licensing regime, that would be fairly obvious fairly quickly. And so we'd certainly support making it mandatory that the register should be created and also that numbers should be shown on advertisements.
Holly.
I just somewhat to echo the comments of others. I think a dog licensing scheme is quite different, and history has kind of proved that it doesn't work terribly well and that there's lots of non-compliance and it's incredibly expensive. So this would probably be preferable. But yes, in theory, the microchipping regulations should allow for that traceability because the breeder should be should be registered as the first keeper of the dog. Unfortunately, in many instances, the breeder will register the new owner either because of a lack of awareness that they should be registered as the first owner or perhaps because they want to circumvent it. But I think the point is when people want to get around something, they will find a way of getting around it, particularly when there's no more resources given to local authorities and enforcement is almost impossible. You are relying on people doing the right thing, which is why, in our view, the code and the certificate is the natural first step and should be bedded in, because the hope is that with that better education and with that greater responsibility taken by the prospective purchaser, these things will naturally get done and we will still have a good supply of home breeders and you know, very low volume breeders breeding dogs.
Okay, thank you. Karen Adam.
Thank you, convener. I'm always quite interested to see how a bill or proposed new legislation can actually help and support a change of a culture. Because, I mean, we're looking at this, I think something we've not mentioned is we're talking about people who are breeding pups for the purpose of making money and using these dogs as commodities, really. And changing that culture in terms of how people view breeding their dogs and buying their dogs. I mean, how can we embed that into this? Do you think, I think you touched upon it a bit there, Holly, it can change that attitude in how we are, you know, buying and selling animals. For example, I have a family member who has Romanian rescue dogs, and that organisation is very strict. They do home visits, and if the dog is not suitable for that family, even if it's up to 2-3 years, if they no longer want to, that animal, that organisation steps in to help rehome it. So they take that responsibility on of that animal, and there's a whole culture that they have around those stray dogs. So I'm just wondering, you know, sorry, it's a bit long-winded, but where does that fit into this bill? Do you think this could change the culture of how we view purchasing and owning a dog?
Anybody want to come in? Claire?
So I think throughout the proposals there are suggestions for a public awareness campaign to be run as well. From Dogs Trust perspective, it is really important to think about behaviour change as part of that. So any campaign not purely raising awareness but actually looking to change behaviour in acquiring a dog. And it's, you know, factors included in that would really be understanding the drivers and the motivations to be able to have a much more focused campaign that could be much more effective in changing behaviour. And then in terms of breeders, like we said, the registration scheme would be a hugely useful first step to kind of bring them into the system, but enforcement is going to be so crucial there as well. And unfortunately, we know local authorities in Scotland are incredibly stretched at enforcing any of the existing legislation, especially the existing activities that are licensed under the licensing of activities involving animals regulations. We actually collectively, as charities, did do some freedom of information requests earlier this year, and we found out that 16% of Scottish councils have not been inspecting animal welfare establishments, which is a requirement, and that did include the largest council in Scotland. So they're hugely under-resourced. We think a clear solution to that would be to have a centralised unit of appropriately trained inspectors that could be used across local authorities in Scotland. We know Wales have done a project looking at this, and it has proven to be fairly successful so far. We think that model would be a hugely important step forward as well in enforcing the legislation, and by actually holding breeders who are unscrupulous and not breeding in to the standards that we would expect, holding them to account and actually enforcing the legislation as well.
I'm going to bring in Holly, and then Jamie's got a question which it follows on from this.
Holly. Yeah, just to say, this would be could be part of a cultural change. I don't think it's going to be the silver bullet that's going to solve the problem and change everybody's ways, but it's the first time that there has been a suggestion of a change in human behaviour when they actually go to acquire a dog. And it would require some degree of huge behaviour change, which we were looking again. Our survey showed nearly 60% of people said social media had the biggest influence on what puppy they got. And that, you know, so that this requires huge change. And this bill could potentially not completely solve the problem, but go some way in helping with that. So yes, that was the point I wanted to make. Also, as a side issue, we do agree with Claire that regarding enforcement, it is so weak at the moment through no fault of the local authorities due to their resources, that actually having a centralised unit in place could actually be really helpful. And again, we would suggest that is in place before we bring in further regulatory requirements, such as the compulsory registration system.
I think it's maybe appropriate. I'm going to bring in Jamie Halker-Johnson for his question, and it might just help inform the point we're discussing at the moment.
Thanks very much, Convener. Yeah, good morning to everyone. It was really along those lines around enforcement and compliance, so it fits kind of nicely in. I mean, every member of this committee here represents a rural or Highland and Islands community. Very difficult to deliver services even at the best of times. Huge pressure on it. This is likely to put additional responsibilities on those, as well as all councils. The suggestion that that perhaps there could be a central body doing that was interesting. So perhaps we could get some ideas of costs and how that would be delivered, because obviously that's a whole new potentially approach. But you know, if this if these regulations, given that previous regulations don't seem to be enforced, and you know this will only be successful if there is the teeth in the enforcement, you know, would you say that without a new approach, either additional resources for councils or a more centralised approach, what confidence do you have that this this new code of conduct will be any better than we've got at the moment?
Can I bring in Jilly first, then I'll go to Claire and then Ben.
Yeah, so this is one of our main concerns, is you're asking an existing resource to do even more and they can't do what they currently are committed to at the moment. We think having a centralised body, like we work very closely with Trading Standards Scotland, as an example, with HMRC when it comes to disruption of the puppy trade, and it's a very much, and it works really, really effectively because you have one body supporting those actions. So we believe that would be of benefit to ensure that this could actually be enacted properly. Just on a previous point, I was going to mention about you can do put a lot of onus on breeders and so on. If the demand's there, those who want to get around the system will get around the system. So that we talked about human behaviour change, the buyer needs to change their behaviours and they need to change, and obviously this is another part of the education piece, but certainly I think having a centralised body, as Claire mentioned, in Wales they have been trialling something of similar. You need to make sure that within that group you've got a group of people who are experienced and trained and know what to look for, particularly when dealing with individuals who are doing everything they possibly can to get round these systems. We've spoken a lot about in previous discussions about canine fertility clinics. You need someone who knows what fertility clinic is, knows how to spot things that aren't quite right. And so having a dedicated team who have the expertise and knowledge and the right training to conduct that would be definitely a preference for us.
You touched on people getting round the rules. There's one section in part two of the regulations that there's an exemption of the first owner of litter of puppies who is not at the time resident in Scotland. Well, that just rings alarm bells immediately. I could nip over the border to Carlisle, say I stayed there for a week, and then believe I'm exempt because that's the time I was going to register them.
That definitely links back. For a long time, we've been calling for a National Animal Offenders Register because people do border hop. We spend a lot of time working with the RSPCA on same individuals who do that. We obviously have a lot of dealings with Ireland, Northern Ireland in particular. We do stops at Kenryan Port, as an example. So for this to be effective, it's very hard at the moment. We've had court cases where someone has been prosecuted down in England, and it's turned up in discussions, oh, actually, they had an offence in Scotland. And then, obviously, you've kind of brought that to light. So people will border hop, and we know that.
I want to bring in Claire and Ben and Libby on this. But, Robbie, what's your perspective from a legal side of the exemptions?
I think our general comments on part two was the fact that the detail isn't clear because it's to be decided by secondary legislation. So that was our overarching comment. In respect of the exemption, it's section 8.2A2. We've not looked at that in any particular detail. It's something that we'd be happy to write to the committee if it's of particular interest, but I wouldn't be best placed to comment on that just now.
Thank you. Claire.
Thank you. I'll touch on both points being discussed here. So first of all, to touch on the exemption for people who aren't resident in Scotland, I think the Scottish Animal Welfare Commission's response actually captured that quite well in terms of amending the current proposal so that where a person in Scotland acquires a dog aged less than 12 months from outside Scotland, they should be required to then enter its detail on the register within a certain time frame. I think it is a concern for us at the moment that that could certainly create a loophole and a way for people to evade the system. But then going back to Jamie's question around the enforcement side of things and what costs could be involved. If we were to look at the Wales model, the Welsh Government funded a pilot which focused on training inspectors in Wales. And I think for us, that's as Julie said, it's just so important that anybody inspecting breeders or other animal establishments, it's so incredibly important that they are trained in that, trained in animal welfare and know what they are looking for. But actually being able to train a central unit of inspectors is likely to be much more cost-effective and efficient as a model. We know it's worked in Wales. So operating together across local authorities, while providing a service across local authorities in Wales, it has improved inspections to increase compliance amongst breeders and increase prosecutions for non-compliance. And I think as well, going back to the rural comment, Aberdeenshire Council has submitted evidence to the committee suggesting that the current suggestion in the financial memorandum is not going to be sufficient. Local authorities, again, through no fault of their own, are under-resourced, and this is going to be a real challenge for them to enforce unless something like a centralised unit of inspectors is considered as an alternative and enough resources put into that.
I'm going to get Ben to comment then and bring Jamie back in a supplementary.
Thank you. I think enforcement for us throughout the bill is a bit of a concern. So I think we've undertaken research last year around the enforcement of animals activities licensing across the UK, and it revealed, perhaps totally unsurprisingly, a very inconsistent picture, a bit of a postcode lottery of what was going on in different local authorities in relation to animal welfare, pronounced differences in structure, training, the number of licensed inspectors, license fees, etc. And although the costs are estimated in the financial memorandum in relation to this bill, I think it needs further research, and certainly, you know, if this bill were to be introduced, really close monitoring to understand the picture. I think there is something around enforcement more broadly that Scottish Government could consider the use and availability of fixed penalty notices for as an alternative enforcement mechanism for technical breaches of legislation where welfare is not compromised, so such as a failure to obtain a registration to sell puppies. But yeah, just to reiterate, I think the enforcement point is a key one, and the costs may need further examination.
Thanks very much. I mean, I'd be interested to know, you know, across the board, maybe not now, but the level of enforcement that's currently existing. But one thing I didn't hear was, I mean, the Welsh pilot government funded, do we know how much that would cost? Has there been estimates if that was rolled out in a Scottish context, given we're a larger population, a more dispersed population, larger rural areas, how that might cost? Obviously, Aberdeenshire, as you said, 24,000, I think it was, but that could be far higher in areas like the Highlands and Islands and the like. So it'd be interesting to know how much the Welsh one costs and what the estimates are for any Scottish pilot.
Libby, and then I'm going to bring in Ariane with a supplement.
Thanks. Thank you. Just very briefly, enforcement across all animal welfare legislation is an issue which is increasingly coming to the fore and is being looked at by the Scottish Animal Welfare Commission at present, although it would be premature to predict what it will be saying. But there is a problem. So certainly resources are going to be needed for this and other legislation. Just in terms of that specific small point about Section 82A, and as Claire's helpfully said, the Commission has made a suggestion for an amendment so that by registering the puppy within 14 days of its arrival, you are effectively the first owner, because clearly the Scottish Parliament cannot legislate for out with Scotland, but as soon as the puppy and thus the first owner are resident in Scotland, that would apply.
Kate Forbes.
Thanks very much. This goes back to a point that Gillie made, which is around enforcement. And as always with any legislation, it might have laudable aims, but if it can't be enforced, then unfortunately we don't see that behavioural change which you are all keen to see. So first question goes back to my earlier comment around certification. To what extent actually will more formalised documentation help with enforcement because there's more of a record? And secondly, is it purely a question of finance in terms of enabling boots on the ground to go and check? Or are there other ways by which you can intercept poor behaviour that doesn't meet the standards?
I think we'll start with Gillie.
So I think from the more documents like certification and so on, we can utilise that and put it as part of a case using obviously the Animal Health and Welfare Scotland Act, showing that
transaction, showing the exchange of knowledge and so on. So it'll just be good to have an added tool. We get told a lot, I didn't know this, don't know where it came from. You try and find the name of the person that they bought the person from, that name doesn't exist. So I think just having that will give us another tool to use. When it comes to the resource, in order, you do need boots on the ground. There are lots of different disruption avenues you can go down. Obviously, looking when we, probably to help, when we go and investigate something, it's not just taking witness statements. You are looking at online activity, you are seizing phones, you are looking at communication between maybe breeders and buyers. We've seen a lot of that through fertility clinics. You're maybe getting vets involved and so on. So there's quite a lot of different professions involved, and there's also a reliance on the physical information gathering, as well as obviously the online search tools that you need. The inspection part and having people going out physically on the ground to inspect and to check that things have been complied with, that's what we're missing at the moment. You don't have that resource to tap into. And it is a money thing. The local authorities do not have the resource to employ more people to go and do that.
Anybody else like to come in on that point? Ben?
It's a fairly obvious point, I'm afraid, but funding and a lack of resource more widely are obviously a perennial problem for local authorities. And I think it may ultimately come down to that here as well, that we need, that the local authorities need more money to be able to enforce both existing animal welfare legislation and this if it is passed.
The root of my question was that you can only enforce or you can only go in on situations that you are aware of. So again, going back to my earlier question, it's much harder, I imagine, to follow up the anonymous guy with a puppy in the boot than it is when actually somebody is already coming into contact with some sort of organisation and body. And presumably, again, this is where the public are really critical in terms of what to look for. And Gillie, you talked, you made a point earlier which I thought was fascinating, where again with certificates you almost have the, you improve the rights of the buyer because they have documentation and proof, perhaps even if that flags up inaccurate details and so on.
As you say, it's the buying population as well. People who have gone down the trap and bought a puppy and it's not survived, they are embarrassed to report it. And that is a behavioural change that we need to get people sort of overcome. In a lot of the campaigns that we've all done, it's very much, you know, walk away, report. Many people don't walk away. They still take because the heart's ruling the head at that moment. So I think it's... You're trying to tackle this from all different angles. The enforcement side, you need buyers to change their behaviour. You need to do the education piece to make this actually work. You can't just do parts of it. Otherwise, it's not going to be successful. You have to do the whole package.
Absolute record. If somebody is tempted to rescue a little puppy in the back of a boot, what should they do?
Walk away and just report, please.
So we've heard about all that this could do, but there's no legislation backing up most of it. What I'm concerned about is you will always get people who want to try and do the right thing, and they don't need the legislation to do that. But what my concern is with what's in front of us, that it could potentially create artificial legitimacy. So you could have people who have got no intention of sticking to the guidelines having more documents, a nice piece of paper to say that they're a verified breeder and whatever, a bit like going to a fake university and getting a diploma, which we know has happened in the past. So giving buyers wrongly placed confidence that who they're buying it from is legitimate without any of the safeguards. So potentially it could create an even more worrying situation where it looks like poor breeders have got some sort of legitimacy because there's no enforcement and no checking and no proper regulations. It seems to me that the this could potentially make things worse. And what we should be looking at is a straightforward national registration scheme, which if you have a puppy, you have a tag. When you scan that tag, the enforcement agencies, whether it's local authorities or SSPCA, can then see who the breeders are, and if there's any issues, then follow that up. That's my view. This seems to be potentially could make things work because there's no policing of these requirements. Jamie Halker-Johnson.
It's a very, very quick kind of point for information on the back of what Kate Forbes was saying there. I mean, if somebody's aware that another person is selling a puppy and they have concerns illegally, you said they should walk away and report it. Who do they report it to? Is there a central number?
Scottish SPCA Animal Helpline. It's open every day of the year.
But is that the only number they should go to?
And
should
they can report to the police as well and
Trading
local authority,
Standards.
Trading Standards Scotland, yes. So there's multiple avenues.
And what chance is there? I mean, even if they walked away, what chance is there of that that being acted on fairly quickly?
Very quickly. So, for instance, if somebody reports about pup in a car park, that might be actually the missing piece to do with somebody that we're already following. And it gives us, we will do test purchases as an example. So if we're getting intelligence to say that somebody keeps going to a supermarket car park every Wednesday or what have you, we will go and do a test purchase in that car park. And we have caught people doing that to approach. So sometimes we need just that extra bit of information to add to the picture that we're already building to then go and actually do an enforcement action. So that's why we always say the more information that we can get, the better, because there's a couple of key groups that are continuously in Scotland doing this type of activity. We sometimes need a bit more information to be able to then action at the different areas, working with Police Scotland at the Port of Kenryan, for example. They'll go as far as taking one car one way and then renting a car when they get on this side of the water. You know, there's different things. So it's a matter of that multi-agency approach. But the more information you can get, the more that you can do. So that's why we need people to report.
And do you think that the awareness of that, of what you can do, and that they could come to you, or they could come to the police, or they could go to trading, is out there amongst the public?
We would do normally the same campaign leading up to Christmas, usually, every time. We have Operation Delphin, which we've spoken about a lot. That is a multi-agency approach with Trading Standards, HMRC, Police Scotland and others. We will be doing more action on that, so we will continuously publicise. You have lots of people say, oh yeah, no, I know about that, but they're not the people who are buying the pups in the car parks. So it's that behaviour change. How do we get across to that audience who are continuing to fuel the demand? Because unless you stop the demand, the trade and everything will still continue.
Thanks.
Any other questions from members or any other of our panellists like to make a comment? Ben, then Libby.
Very quickly, in the context of this bill, I think that comes back to the public awareness side of it being so important. It would need to be sustained, use multiple channels of communication, and it would also, the code of practice, for example, would need to be included on relevant websites where dogs are being bought and sold. So Pets for Homes, Gumtree, etc. So you just have to ensure that there really was the public awareness drive that would marry up with the legislation too.
Thank you. Libby.
And again, very quickly, while there is a concern about enforcement, the register itself will be an aid to enforcement because it provides that resource, that intelligence, and one would hope it will make it easier for local authority officers or Scottish SPCA inspectors to check out somebody's credentials and their activities. So there is a distinct positive to having it.
Well, thank you very much. Thank you for your time this morning. That's been hugely useful. And now that concludes our business in public, and we will now move into private session and suspend the meeting for a 10-minute comfort break.